with unions, local authorities, teachers and parents as we progress with this work.
Thank you very much. That concludes questions this afternoon. Before we start the debate, I need to remind members that legal proceedings are ongoing in relation to the legislative competence of the named persons provision. That matter is therefore sub judice for the purposes of standing orders, and I will allow general debate on the issues set out in the motion. However, no specific reference should be made to the merits of the precise legal arguments being considered other than in factual terms. So that then brings us to the debate, the next item of business, which is a debate on motion number 14999 in the name of Liz Smith on named persons. Members wishing to speak should press their buttons now, please, and to call in Liz Smith to speak to and move the motion. Ms Smith, no more than 14 minutes. We're incredibly tight for time.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move the motion in my name. 3 years ago, when this Parliament first debated in earnest the SNP's plans to introduce a named person, concerns were raised across the Chamber not just about the principles of the policy, but about how workable it actually would be. Ken McIntosh, Hugh Henry, Tavish Scott and John Mason all expressed their concerns, specifically about the fact that if the policy was to be mandatory for all young people from birth to 18, what strains that would place on the authorities. Mike Russell, the then Education Secretary, acknowledged in the Scottish Government's programme for government debate on the 4th of September 2013 that he could understand some of these concerns, and he also raised those ones that had been issued by critics that perhaps it represented state intervention. But he went on to say that he had been eventually persuaded of the need for the policy on the account of the track record of what it could do to help our most vulnerable children. I think he gave examples of children in Forfar who, in his opinion, had benefited greatly from a named person type service. Maggie Mellon, the highly respected former social worker, Carol Ford, former leader of School Leaders Scotland, Tricia Hall, the Scottish Association of Social Workers, Jenny Cunningham, experienced paediatrician, all raised their concerns, but we were told that the named persons were essential if we were to avoid a repeat of the Daniel Pelka case, Baby P case, or any other horrific child abuse case, which everyone in this Parliament agrees are very serious issues that need to be urgently tackled. Indeed, if you examine all the supportive evidence on named persons that was submitted to the Education Committee at the time of the Children and Young People's Bill, it came almost exclusively from groups who are tasked with looking after our most vulnerable children. And I do not think that anyone in this Parliament doubts the sincerity with which that case was made. Yet that, Deputy Presiding Officer, is precisely the reason why the universal aspect of this policy is so wrong-headed. Of course these children need help. If I can just make a little bit of progress, Mr Chisholm, just now. Of course these children need help. And of course every effort must be made to assist local authorities, teachers, social workers, police, etc., to address the issue of our most vulnerable sectors of society. But as the Assistant Chief Constable Malcolm Graham said in the summer, this is exactly why the resources should be directed to our most vulnerable children. Some of his police colleagues feared that by making it compulsory for every child, it will be much less possible to direct sufficient attention to those children who need it most. And they worry that there would be... Yes, I would.
Matt McDonald.
The member will, of course, be aware of the Pathfinder project in Highland. And the outcome of the Pathfinder project showed 75% time saved for professionals, 50% reduction in caseload of social workers, 70% fall in unnecessary referrals to the reporter, and 50% reduction in the number of children regarded as at risk of significant harm. That surely demonstrates that the policy works.
Liz Smith.
The member will be also aware of the fact that the conclusion to the Pathfinder study was there was no proof that that was due to named persons or GIRFEC, no conclusive evidence. That's exactly what the committee said. Now, of course, people are concerned. The police are not alone in raising these concerns about workload. Greg Dempster, the Association of Heads and Deputies in Scotland, said at the Education Committee only 2 weeks ago that this policy was probably the single biggest paperwork burden currently placed on head teachers in our schools. And here is why. No fewer than 306 different criteria in the Shinari indices that have to be dealt with by teachers when it comes to assessing children. That's one of the essential problems about this policy. Now, of course, the financial burdens were something that were scrutinised by the Finance Committee, which, despite Aileen Campbell's assurances in a parliamentary answer on the 27th of June 2014, that the financial memorandum set out the full cost of the policy, it made it clear in the Finance Committee that that policy hadn't been properly costed. something that is clearly set out also in the Spice briefing. My colleague Gavin Brown will say more about this, but the Finance Committee was not persuaded by the Scottish Government's assertions that the £26 million cost to schools, local authorities and health boards for 2016-17 would actually diminish much year on year, given that there has to be ongoing training and paperwork for every child in the system, which is exactly what yesterday's guidance from the Scottish Government actually said, and it's what's been confirmed by the Royal College of Nursing today. In recent months, the Scottish Government has gone on a major charm offensive to persuade parents that all is well and that the named persons are really in the best interests of everyone. First, there was the Hampden initiative, when parents could turn up on a family day out, a £25 gift voucher thrown in to persuade them of the merit so that they could find out all they wanted to know. Then we had the Shinari wheel of wellbeing diagrams, which I have to say in vain is an example of just exactly what is wrong with this policy. And now we've got a hopscotch play, which is starring Mr. Shinari and Miss Gerfek, which is being taken round primary schools. And every time when someone criticises these initiatives, the Scottish Government goes on the defensive and argues that actually there is no compulsion on parents to accept any advice from a named person. This, I may say, is despite the fact that the Scottish Government persistently refused all the amendments to the Children and Young People's Bill, which would have permitted an opt-out. Yet they know full well that the professionals are not permitted to opt out. So common sense, of course, tells you if the professionals cannot opt out, then neither can the parents, because they are inextricably linked when it comes to the adoption of a named person policy. That is something that was admitted by an Inverness primary school headteacher when she was asked on the BBC Kay Adams programme, what would she do if parents indicated that they didn't want a named person? She replied that it would be her job to persuade them otherwise. So this requirement for full cooperation and positive engagement with a professional's viewpoint is further illustrated with the inclusion in the risk indicators the following: whether a parent is resisting or limiting engagement, or whether the parent has a completely different perception of the problem. So quite clearly, parents can choose not to engage and not to accept the advice, but the consequences of doing that are to be, well, let's be honest, they are endangering the well-being of their child, because they're going to be picked upon. They are being picked upon as parents who are not worthy. So at the end of the day, No, it's not disgraceful. This is exactly...
Order, please. We can't have sedentary interventions.
This is exactly what is happening in our schools. So at the end of the day, and despite all the protestations which we're seeing just now on the SNP benches, families are being judged over subjective assessments of the well-being of their child. Not at all, says the Scottish Government. It's only scaremongering. We heard that in the question time. No intervention, they tell us, could ever take place without consultation with the parents. But they are wrong. No, they are wrong. Of course.
Minister.
I thank the member for giving way. And we've already heard the example of Highland raised, which, of course, used a very similar system prior to the introduction of this one. Has she any evidence that either parents or children were picked upon in Highland as a result of that system being in existence?
Since
she uses that phrase.
I've got every evidence, and you've seen it in the newspapers, about many of the parents who are fed up by being told what it is that they have to agree to. And this is something that you seem to think, or the Scottish Government seems to think, is not an issue. It's a huge issue, because it's not there by consent. It's being imposed. The Scottish Government keeps telling us this is a right. But the fact of the matter is, parents cannot opt out of this system. That's the issue. Now, Deputy Presiding Officer and I listened very carefully to the instructions yesterday about what we can and cannot say. And I know that the Scottish Government has obviously got to answer some other questions when it comes to that legal proceeding. We can't talk about that. But I do ask the Scottish Government to consider the fact that the Information Commissioner's Office has admitted, as a result of the Children and Young People's Act, that practitioners can share information, including confidential information, without parental consent. They have also acknowledged that the bar of intervention has altered from one being of significant harm merely to well-being. Now, I can't comment any further on that at the time because it's part of a legal proceeding. But, of course, what is really at issue here is the problem about the definition of well-being. It's a problem that runs through the Children and Young People's Act, and it's also an increasing problem within the Education Bill currently at Stage 2 in committee. Yes, of course.
Minister?
And what element of Shinari does Bliss Smith disagree with?
Bliss Smith.
I have to say, how on earth can you accept that this is an acceptable way of assessing a child? It's this kind of paperwork. It's this...
Minister, please stop shouting from a sedentary position. Liz Smith.
I think the Minister is perhaps getting a little uptight. And perhaps that shares exactly what many parents feel about that. So, Deputy Presiding Officer, if the practice of this policy is so flawed, it is nothing when it comes to making an assessment about the fundamental principles. And I choose my words carefully again in the right light of the ruling just made. What is implicit in this proposal to have a named person for every child is the insistence that the state, rather than the parents and families, has the primary obligation to look after children. That is entirely the wrong way round, because there are thousands of parents across Scotland doing a thoroughly good job. So what right does the Scottish Government to tell them that the state knows better? What on earth is the point? What on earth is the point of insisting that these families have a named person on exactly the same basis as those families who face genuine problems? The logic on that is completely lost. The essential trust, if I may just continue for a minute, the essential trust, and perhaps the Cabinet Secretary can answer this, the essential trust, which is the crucial ingredient on which to build a successful relationship between parent and child and between family and teacher, health visitor, social worker, is by definition under threat if there is a third party who is deemed to have more authority over that party.
Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary.
The question I wanted to ask Ms Smith was, tell me, how do you assess the needs of a child? Do you assess all children in a fair, professional manner? Or do you make some lazy assumptions about which children are deserving, which children are undeserving? And do you base that on facts and professionalism? Or do you base that, as you do, on ideology, on the assumption that some children will, of course, need intervention, while others will never need
Ms.
intervention?
Cabinet Secretary, I think some teachers in our schools, some professionals might take great acceptance to what you have just said. They are the professionals. They are trained to do their job. The SNP is very quick, in fact, to tell us that it wholeheartedly espouses a liberal democratic tradition and it wants to do more to increase our personal freedoms by promoting greater inequality and social justice. Yet its policy towards young people has become increasingly paternalistic and orientated towards the role of the state. Named persons are the prime example of pushing the boundaries of the state too far. The rights of children do not stand in isolation. That was a point made by Alistair Allen at committee yesterday. They should be seen in the context of the rights of parents and families, and the responsibilities of these families must articulate with the needs of all individuals within these families. Expecting all children to have a named person is an assault on the responsibility of families and parents for whom there are no problems. And that's exactly why 74% of parents surveyed by the Scottish Parent Teacher Council argued that there was no need for a named person. Last year, the Scottish Government made a huge play of the fact that 16 and 17-year-olds should have the right to vote, a point we entirely agree with. If they're old enough and mature enough to vote, old enough to marry, old enough to fight for their country, why must they also have a named person? And why must a young 17 or 18-year-old couple with a child have three named persons in that family? I rest my case, Deputy Presiding Officer, on the fact that this policy has two fundamental problems. It takes resources away from our most vulnerable children. That is inexcusable. But secondly, it is completely against the trust and responsibility that parents and families deserve. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I now call on Aileen Campbell to speak to and to move Amendment 14999.2. Minister, maximum 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'm proud that this Parliament took
the groundbreaking Children and Young People Scotland Act through Parliament last year. That Act was a huge milestone for this Parliament. For the first time, we gave comprehensive legislative substance to our ambition of giving Scotland's children the best start in life. And I'm proud because I know that at the heart of this Act is a commitment to improve wellbeing for all our nation's children and young people. Every child has only one shot at childhood, so it's incumbent upon us all, parents, practitioners and policymakers, to do our very best to realise that commitment. It's the Parliament's right and duty to scrutinise our legislation, to influence change and to improve policy and laws. I uphold that completely and have always sought to engage constructively with others, regardless of their party political beliefs. Because, Presiding Officer, the well-being of our children and young people transcends party politics. Indeed, that philosophy shared across this chamber led Parliament to unite behind the GIRFEC principles under the previous administration and over the years that followed up to the passage of the Act. We should now reflect on how we got to where we are. The named person was developed on the ground through the GIRFEC Highland Pathfinder, which has interested and inspired this Parliament for many years now. Parliamentarians were impressed. 6 years ago, almost to the day, one MSP said, "A key success of the Highland Pathfinder project has been the reduction in bureaucracy, which has freed up more time for direct work with children. Another outcome is better information sharing that has also reduced the burden on staff." He went on to conclude, "I very much welcome the Minister's commitment to implement the GIRFEC programme throughout Scotland on the back of the successful pilot in the Highlands." I find Murdo Fraser's words entirely reassuring. Mary Scanlon is another Conservative MSP who has acknowledged this policy's benefits. During the very same debate, she said, "For too long, children and others have suffered as agencies work in their silos, refusing to share information that would lead to a holistic approach to addressing a child's needs. I commend the work done in Highland to address that issue. That contact with families in the home enables those health professionals to identify at an early stage likely problem areas and potentially vulnerable groups." And I draw attention to the views previously expressed by member. Okay.
Will the Minister specify simply what is it at the moment precludes authorities from intervening where they believe a child to be at risk?
Minister.
We have child protection laws in place, but this as a system has been proven to demonstrate good positive outcomes for children, as outlined by Mark MacDonald in his intervention to Liz Smith. But going back to why I drew upon those previous contributions and previous debates by members of the Conservative benches, and I did that for no other reason than to show the party's direction of travel on GIRFEC, from urging us to roll out it nationally to a Mail on Sunday article by Ruth Davison that was distasteful as it was hyperbolic. In it, she used the tragic deaths of Victoria Climbie and Baby P in an effort, one can only assume, to scare people for her own cynical political ends. No one can ever guarantee that no child can slip through the net, but Ruth Davison well knows that the consensus across Scotland's children's organisations and charities, the people who know and understand these issues best, is that the named person will help make those holes in the net smaller. And for the avoidance of doubt, the heartbreaking cases... Of course, if she wants to talk about her article.
Ruth Davison.
Would she also acknowledge that in that article, the testimony that was given by senior members of Scotland's police force said that this would change the focus away from the children that needed it most and, in fact, may leave them more at risk?
Yeah. Minister.
I also know that the Police Scotland have been a very full and constructive member of the programme board and supportive of the named person, and have said so many times in the progression of the Act through the Parliament. Now, for the avoidance of doubt, those heartbreaking cases that Ruth Davison cited in her article, and she cites from London, had absolutely nothing to do with the named person or any similar provision for protecting children. And I actually hope that Ruth Davison reflects on those parallels that she sought to draw, and I hope that she hangs her head in shame for doing so. Because here are the facts. The Getting It Right for Every Child approach puts the best interests of the child at the heart of decision-making to ensure their well-being. It works with, not around or against, children, young people and their families. It embeds early intervention and prevention, and it stipulates that professionals must work together across professional boundaries in the best interests of the child.
GIRFIC has been developed in response to families' needs. Parents don't want to have to tell or even shout their stories over and over again to a crowd of services. They just want appropriate support if and when they need it. And any one of us just might need support with parenting, however much or little at one time or another. Early intervention means tackling the small, persistent issues in a child's life, the ones that aren't easy to resolve by a family alone before they escalate into a crisis. We hear a lot, and particularly from Liz Smith, about vulnerable children and families as though they walk around with signs on their heads. We can't predict which child or which young person will become the ones that our services need to support. I've taken two already, and must make progress. We can't predict which mum might suffer postnatal depression or which family might suffer a bereavement. And that's where the real issue of workloads comes from. If we want to ensure that resources are concentrated on those who really need it, we need to do what we can to help children and families at the earliest possible stage. That isn't diverting resources, that's directing them. GIRFEC and the named person are supported by professionals as well. We know that they have a more positive impact on children and families' lives when they work together. We hear it regularly, loudly in those tragic cases where children have come to harm, and quietly, but no less powerfully, when it comes to helping children and family with the ordinary stresses and strains of everyday life. But don't take my word for it. Parenting across Scotland, Aberlour, Barnardo Scotland, Children First, One Parent Families Scotland, Action for Children are just some of the professional organisations who backed this legislation. And they back it because they know the named person does not replace parents or professionals. Of course they don't, but helps make the links between them if and when they need it to be made. The named person isn't someone new or unknown. It is a trusted person who's already working with the child and the family. The legislation simply builds on that trust and strong relationship. The Inner House of the Court of Session recently threw out the legal challenge made to the named person, a challenge that was now been defeated twice. It found that the legislation does not involve the state taking over any functions currently carried out by parents, that the mere creation of a named person available to assist a child or parent no more confuses or diminishes the legal role, duties and responsibilities of parents in relation to their children than the provision of social services or education generally, and that it has no effect whatsoever on the legal, moral or social relationships within the family. Lord Carloway also said the campaign narrative against the named person had the appearance of hyperbole. I would offer that the same description be applied to Ruth Davidson's article and her party's new approach on this issue. And I stress new because the Children and Young People Act has a long time in the making. It's not a bolt from the blue, but it is being introduced at a time when we are seeing an assault from the blue, an assault by the UK Tory government that will remove a staggering £960 million from the incomes of families with children in Scotland. Yeah. If the Conservative Party wants to know what threatens family life in Scotland, then it need look no further than itself. Yeah. If the Conservative motion, they talk about diverting the resources away from the most vulnerable children, let me remind them that there was the Scottish Conservatives that are seeing 36,000 children in Scotland now relying on food banks thanks to Tory austerity. Yeah. Let me remind them that it's the UK welfare reforms that will push 100,000 additional children into poverty by 2020. If we wanted to divert resources away from the most vulnerable children, we wouldn't have to look very far for ideas. But I'm proud that this government seeks to invest in our children rather than to deprive them. Presiding Officer, the GIRFIC policy has been shaped over many years in partnerships with professionals and with parents. It's been supported and praised by parties across this chamber and children's organisations, and it has been tested twice in the courts. I have every confidence this legislation is making a difference and a life better for children right across this country. Challenges remain and Parliament has a duty to scrutinise, but there is constructive scrutiny and there is politicking. Children should not be treated as political footballs, and I'm afraid to say that that's what the Scottish Conservatives have turned this issue into. And I hope they reflect and in return take a constructive approach to GIRFIC as they once previously did in this chamber.
Could you move your amendment, please, Minister? Could you move your amendment, please?
I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. I now call on Ian Gray to speak to move amendment 14999.1, maximum 6 minutes, Mr Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We often begin these debates by congratulating the relevant party for bringing the debate forward. But I can't do that today because this is indeed a calculatedly unhelpful debate brought by the Tories in their efforts to whip up concern, even fear, amongst parents and others about the named person policy passed some time ago by this Parliament. Now, the Tory motion may not do that explicitly, but Ruth Davidson's disgraceful remarks at the weekend suggesting that this policy will lead to deaths like those of Baby P in Victoria Climbie give the game away, and the Minister was right to take her to task for it. They are shamelessly allying themselves for perceived party advantage with completely untrue and hyperbolic headlines which have variously described the named person as state guardian, shadow parent, replacements for parents, spies on parents, and the politicisation of parents. These stories have suggested that named persons will invade the family home to check what TV programmes children are watching while indoctrinating the same children with a named person sing-along, which Ms Smith referred to, in fact, in her speech today.
Ms Smith.
I thank Mr Gray for giving way. Does he approve of the hopscotch play that has been taken round our primary schools?
Ian Gray.
Well, I confess I haven't seen it, but since it is a play around rights respecting schools, an initiative which schools in my constituency support with great success, I think it probably would. But I also note from the coverage that when asked, hopscotch said not only was this not about the named person policy, they didn't even know what that policy was. All of this is complete nonsense. It is the equivalent of the old stories from Europe that they will straighten bananas and rename the British banger and ban the fireman's pole. None of this will happen. And we know that none of it will happen because the named person system already operates, albeit on a non-statutory basis, in Highland, in Edinburgh, in Fife and in other local authority areas. And parents remain unusurped by named persons, big brothers snooping on family life. Of course they do, because the named person is not a new official imposed on the family, but rather an existing professional who already works with that family, usually a teacher or a health visitor. Experience from Highland shows that most parents will have no reason to contact their named person in that capacity at all. And the idea of the named person, after all, did come from parents who wanted a single point of contact if needed. But it also came from the fact that when tragedies do happen, subsequent reviews always point to services not being good enough at sharing information. We only have to think of the tragedy of Declan Haney to remember what happens when no single service takes responsibility for a child's welfare. And as for diluting attention to vulnerable children, surely those most at risk are those not yet identified as vulnerable. As Martin Crewe of Barnardo says, children are not born with an at-risk label plastered to their forehead. We need to get better at recognising the warning signs, because even one failure is unforgivable.
I'm very grateful to the member for giving way. On that very point, surely it would be better to use the resources going into the named person scheme to fund a proper universal system of health visitors. Would that not be better identifying children most in need?
Let me get to resources. So we cannot support the Tory motion, which is indeed code for opposition in principle to the policy. But look, the government cannot pat themselves on the back either. When we supported the named person policy, we raised serious concerns. We opposed its extension to 18. We asked about guidance and how it would allay fears. We demanded assurances on resourcing and complained about the fact that a proper financial memorandum was not available at the time. And we were right to do so. But the government simply banked our support for the principle and squandered the goodwill behind it. They have utterly failed to defend this policy against the wildest of these scare stories. They have allowed these stories to gain credence and create real and sincere concerns among some parents. They have done nothing to respect those concerns or to respond to them. The draft guidance is heavy-handed, and 90% of respondents thought sections were not clear. And if the government think cunningly getting a redraft out late yesterday gets them off the hook, They are kidding themselves. Meanwhile, those on whom the actual work of the new system will fall have seen resources squeezed, not provided. And this I agree with Mr Fraser. The NHS budget has not been protected. Councils have seen cuts doubled and passed on to them. Police Scotland has shed 2,500 staff and faces a multi-million pound shortfall. And teachers are balloting for industrial action because government has increased their workload to a point they can't accept. We cannot support a government amendment which simply fails yet again to give any guarantee whatsoever on resources to support this policy. This is just another case, like the National Improvement Framework or HE governance, where the government may be doing the right thing in principle, but the implementation is utterly incompetent. They say you campaign in poetry and govern in prose. This government spends so much time reciting the self-love poetry of its own poll numbers that it repeatedly lets the prose of government go to hell in a handcart.
Mr Gray, you must
close. Support the policy, yes, because it's right, but support the means to make it happen too. I move the amendment in my name.
Many thanks. We now turn to the open debate. At this point of the debate, speeches will be up to 6 minutes. That may have to be reviewed later on in the debate. George Adam to be followed by John Pentland.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. At one point during Ian Gray's speech, I was actually going to say what Ian Gray had said and agree with him, but then the second half of his speech, I didn't agree with any of it. So, obviously, I rise here again in the Chamber to take part, and it's an honour to be part of this debate, Presiding Officer. Yes, no problem.
Ian Gray.
The second half of my speech simply asked that the government commit to provide adequate resources for this policy to happen. Surely even Mr Adam can agree with
George
that.
George Adam.
That's not what the second half of your speech actually did, Mr Gray. But many of us, regardless of our political parties, actually became involved in politics to change our communities and to change lives. And I don't doubt anyone's reasons for getting involved in politics, regardless of the political party. But I do believe on this occasion, Presiding Officer, that the Tories have got the tone of this debate completely, utterly wrong. Because for the Tory leader, Ruth Davidson, to write what I find inexcusable is actually the column that she wrote with regards to this issue, because that is not what this issue is about. And then I'm even more further disappointed with Liz Smith, who is someone I've worked with over the past number of years, who's always been someone you can actually disagree with, but you can actually come to a compromise at the end. To come away with some of the things she said today was, for me personally, very disappointing. You know, but changing communities, you know, if you look at Liz Smith, you know, she's actually already said, I am particularly pleased to welcome the results of the Highland Pathfinder GIRFEC project, especially on the progress that's been made in measuring outcomes much more effectively, making improvements in professional practice, and with better multi-agency working and developing a more holistic approach that needs the child, something that we all agree is one of the most important issues. Now, that was what Liz Smith said before. Has Liz Smith changed her mind on that?
Liz Smith has very definitely not changed her mind. Could I ask the member to explain where is the evidence that it was the named person in the Highland Pathfinder is, because that's not what the conclusion says.
George Adam.
Ms Smith, by welcoming the actual Pathfinder project, you welcomed that as well, because that is part of the actual project itself. But can, Presiding Officer, can we actually get to this place where we say that I believe that GIRFEC is the way forward for all our children, to make sure it's a basic human need to make sure that everything's okay for our children. And in no way does the named person replace the role of a parent or carer, nor does it undermine our families. In fact, the named person may provide much needed support during very difficult times. No family or individual can deal with challenging circumstances on their own. Of course, children and parents have no obligation to use the service, unlike what was said earlier on today, or take up advice or help offered. That alone dismisses one of the many myths that have been created regarding this issue. I believe that this is the right policy, and I believe it's the right way forward. Every child should have a safe and stable environment to grow up. I was lucky to be brought up by a loving and caring family, and I'm sure most people in this room also benefited from a stable family life. However, not every child has a safe and secure home. Not every child in the real world has a situation where they have that love and support. And when that difficult time comes, then it's down to having a named person to help during that situation. Now, much has been said, I think Mr Gray brought up about the Declan Haney case. Now, that happened within Paisley. And I don't believe that any legislation, regardless of what you do, will stop people bad people doing bad things. It's inevitable that there will be, but you've got to do everything you can to make sure that these things don't happen. And when I read the reports when I was a councillor and later on in the Declan Haney case, the situation was that you had no one who took up the responsibility of that child. Both no one was legislated, both health and social care were actually to blame at various points in that whole case. And I read the reports from one cover to the other. No one was to actual blame. The problem was there was no individual whose responsibility was to make sure that was okay. And that, to me, shows the need for the named child, because the named person's role is to provide, to respond to requests to help children and young people, person or parent, is to provide that type of support. I don't believe it's going to be the situation of deciding what television shows are going to watch and some of the scare stories that have come out here as well. But recently I was contacted by our local newspaper, the Paisley Daily Express, and they were talking about, I know this debate isn't about foster parents, but they were starting a campaign in Renfrewshire Council to get more foster parents, because I believe it's important that we give every single child. That's why I believe totally in the Girfec policies, and that's why I was quite happy to give them a quote supporting Renfrewshire Council and their 712 children that they support. And say that they had this opportunity to promote this further. Now, for me, presiding officer, I think we have to get away from the scare stories. I think we have to move away from the so-called myths that, you know, a named person does not replace, I think I've said that, change the role of a parent. And the named person approach is not new. It's not something that just came out of the blue. It's something that's been part of a concentrated project, which Liz Smith previously supported, but doesn't appear to do so now. So I say, presiding officer, you know, for me, this is a very important issue. It's part of Girfec, and it's also the reason why we need to make sure that we never have these situations again where young children end up in a position where they're left, or the tragic circumstances that sometimes have happened. I have been disgusted with the tone that the Tory party have brought to this debate, but I'm not surprised, because they're appealing to the basic common denominator here, and that's very disappointing in this debate. But what I will say to finish, presiding officer,
must close, please.
This is the way forward to make sure that we do get the opportunity to make Scotland the best place for children, all children, to grow up in.
Thank you. I have to be clear that members cannot go over 6 minutes, and even at that, later on, some members may be reduced to five. John Pentland, to be followed by Stuart Maxwell.
Presiding officer, the idea of having a named person is basically a good one. In principle, it's hard to see a good argument against having someone who is a link between children, their parents and professionals, bringing together those involved in a child's life, and crucially, someone who can look out for vulnerable children and ensure that they do not fall through society's safety net. Of course, my support for the principle is subject to it being properly put into practice. It needs to be adequately resourced, and those undertaking that role need to be well trained, and it also needs trust. Scottish Labour argued at every stage of the bill that the system must work in practice and be properly resourced without placing an additional burden on staff or taking away support from children who need it most. These weren't just the Scottish Labour's concerns, but were backed by the RCN, the EIS and others. Done badly, the scheme could add a burden of bureaucracy while providing little help to those who should benefit. Done very badly, it would be counterproductive. But the pilot scheme showed it could be done well, and this has led to it being broadly welcomed by local authorities, health boards and children's organisations, and rolled out across the country. Children organisations such as Barnado's, Children First, Save the Children, the NSPCC and the Children in Scotland were and remain very supportive of the bill, and recognise the importance of the named person to Girfec. Scottish Labour also argued the provision should only apply to young people up to 16. And I still don't understand why a named person is needed for someone who's old enough to decide the future of their country, but then consistency is not a strong point of nationalism. Suffice to say, the Scottish Government ignored these calls and failed to address the concerns of parents. Now, on the question of trust, the Scottish Government is doing extremely badly, and perhaps that's because they have already given people other reasons to mistrust them, between their centralising tendencies, their avoidance of scrutiny, and their riding roughshod over civil liberties, such as spying on journalists, stop and search, and the super ID database being introduced by the back door. Now, this Big Brother reputation has fed the intense dislike felt by some towards the named person proposals. And in reality, the public just don't trust the named person in the hands of the SNP. Now, to be fair, this dislike is also compounded by misunderstanding about the purpose of the named person. In most cases, this will be a health visitor or a teacher who already fulfils, at least in part, the role of the named person, and the legislation formalises that role. It does not seek to provide a social worker for every child. It is not a state guardian, and it doesn't replace the role of parents in any way. Indeed, we are assured that in most cases, communication will primarily be between parents and the named person, and that parents will control the relationship with that named person. However, the named person does allow problems to be identified and support provided earlier. The effect of this should be less costly interventions at a later stage, making better use of resources for those who need them most. Yet today, rather...
Minister.
I thank the member for giving way, and I've been listening carefully to what he's been saying. My reading of it is that really he actually agrees with the Scottish Government on this issue. Can he not just bring himself to say it?
John Pentland.
I've already said, Minister, that I agree in principle with the named person, but there's a lot of faults behind that, and you really need to listen to those faults and those concerns.
Through the chair, please.
However, the named person does allow problems to be identified and support provided earlier. You know, the effect of this should be less costly interventions at a later stage, making better use of resources for those who need them most. But yet today, rather than address the people's misconceptions and fears, the Conservatives are cynically playing on them. Now, part of their scaremongering is to suggest that information will be withheld from parents and that they will be excluded from important decisions in a child's life. Now, as a rule, this will not be the case. If it is, there should be a good reason.
Final minute.
And contrary to what some believe, these do exist. For starters, children have the rights to privacy, and if they choose to tell a professional something in confidence, they have the right to expect that will be respected. Now, such confidence may be necessary to enable them to disclose abuse, and we would fail in our duty to the most vulnerable children if that is not the case. We have had too many such failures, and the named person scheme done right is part of the safety net that can help to prevent such cases. Presiding officer, the named person scheme is there for an admirable and valuable purpose. We shouldn't try to undermine it, and we should be ensuring it's fit for purpose.
Thank you very much. I now call Stuart Maxwell to be followed by Liam MacArthur.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. A couple of weeks ago, my colleague Rod Campbell led a members' debate to mark Universal Children's Day, the day chosen by the United Nations to promote the welfare of children across the world. Although I personally wasn't able to participate in that debate, I was interested to hear the contributions from MSPs across the Chamber on our obligation to ensure that every child is given the opportunity to enjoy their childhood with freedom and dignity. In the opening remarks of his members' debate, Rod Campbell quoted UN Secretary-General Ban Ki-moon, and I think it's worth doing so again. The one thing all children have in common is their rights. Every child has the right to survive and thrive, to be educated, to be free from violence and abuse, to participate and to be heard. These are fundamental rights, Presiding Officer, but sadly we know that for some children these rights are not always protected. I was fortunate enough to be invited by Barnardo's to visit one of their local services in East Renfrewshire to highlight Universal Children's Day. I met with volunteers who worked tirelessly to support the excellent work that Barnardo's does for Scotland's most vulnerable children and young people. And as we have heard, Barnardo's is just one of a broad coalition of children's charities who are advocates of the named person provisions contained in the Children and Young People Act. Aberlour, who last night held a reception marking 140 years of supporting Scotland's young people, and Action for Children, who recently celebrated its 60th year of supporting Scotland's young people, are two other well-established children's charities that also back these measures. Other supporters, as we've already heard, include Quarriers, Children in Scotland, NSPCC, Who Cares Scotland, Mentor, One Parent Families Scotland and Children First. These are all charities that are dedicated to improving the lives of Scotland's children and young people. The fact that they are all advocates of the named person policy is, in my view, strong evidence that implementing this policy is the right thing to do. Nonetheless, like many in the Chamber, I've been contacted by constituents who have raised concerns about the named person, so I am prepared to listen to the arguments on why the Scottish Government needs to look again at the policy. However, it seems to me that many of the criticisms raised about the named person are based on misinformation and misunderstanding of what the policy is actually about. For example, one constituent who contacted me was worried about what impact the named person policy would have on parents who choose not to have their child vaccinated. Of course, there are no provisions in the Act which would permit a named person to forcibly vaccinate a child. Indeed, the named person has no powers to compel parents or children to do anything without their consent. We've also heard concerns raised by parents that the named person will meddle with how their child's bedroom is decorated and what television programmes they watch. These concerns are not based in fact. This is not about introducing a snooper's charter that undermines the roles of parents. I'll give way.
Alec Jones.
I was just going to ask if you could tell me what he understands by the word well-being.
Stuart Maxwell.
Well, frankly, frankly, that's a ridiculous intervention. If you don't understand what it is that we are trying to achieve about the well-being of children in this country, I think you should go and have a serious look at yourself. That's incredible.
Mr. Maxwell, through the chair, please.
I do apologise, Presiding Officer, but the members should have a serious look at themselves if that's the level of intervention they want to make in a serious debate like we're having today. The Cabinet Secretary and the Minister have been clear that the role of the named person is to advise and support, and those who do not wish to engage with a named person are under no obligation to do so. The Conservatives have described this policy as a monstrous invasion into family life, yet Lord Pentland, in his judgment following the court challenge, was clear in refuting this assertion. Presiding Officer, I was extremely disappointed to read Ruth Davidson's comments in the Sunday Press, which appear to be an attempt to scare people into believing that the named person policy is not fit for purpose. To cite the murders of Baby P and Victoria Climby, two harrowing and tragic cases of child abuse, and suggest that the named person policy could actually lead to tragedies such as these being more likely in Scotland is seriously, seriously misguided and not borne out by the evidence, and I think she should seriously consider what she has said and withdraw those remarks. Martin Crewe, director of Barnardo's Scotland, has said that many of the criticisms directed towards the named person provisions are not justified. In the briefing paper provided ahead of today's debate, Barnardo's offered a strong rebuttal to the concerns raised by the Conservatives in pointing out the importance of having in place an early warning system to identify children who are most at risk. Children aren't conveniently divided into groups that identify themselves as either vulnerable or not at risk. The point made by Barnardo's that the child most at risk is the one who has not yet been identified as being at risk is an important one, and one that Ruth Davidson and her colleagues would do well to reflect on. The Highland Pathfinder found that the named person does not waste resources or put at risk the safety of children. In fact, it demonstrated a reduction in the workload of the professionals involved because support was given before problems developed into crisis. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the named person provisions in the Children and Young People Act have been endorsed by Parliament, and the subsequent legal challenge to the legislation have been rejected in their entirety by the Court of Session. However, that's not to say that there still isn't work to be done. There is clearly a degree of misunderstanding about the named person, which is leading to anxiety amongst some parents. More must be done to address this, and I certainly welcome the Cabinet Secretary's assurances and the Minister's assurances that the Scottish Government will continue to work with parent groups and others to address any legitimate concerns ahead of the implementation of the measures next year. I am very proud of the work this Parliament undertook in bringing forward the Children and Young People Act. It's unfortunate that many of the excellent provisions in the legislation are being overshadowed to an extent by the misinformation about the named person. When I spoke during the Stage 3 debate of the legislation, I said that the implementation of GIRFECT across Scotland would go a long way to ensuring that no child is left without support. I've heard no compelling evidence to make my change that view.
I'm afraid you must close.
And I am disgusted by the fact that the Conservatives are just carrying on with misinformation and leading to more misunderstandings about this legislation.
Thank you. And I give fair warning that members may have to be cut off at 6 minutes. Liam MacArthur to be followed by Chick Brodie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I appreciate the role of the named person as one to which both Liz Smith and her colleagues are implacably opposed, and I very much respect that position, though I disagree with it. But some of the language used to convey that opposition has been neither accurate nor helpful, and only likely to spread, I think, undue alarm amongst parents and the wider public. And in that sense, I agree absolutely with the criticisms, I think, levelled by Ian Gray, if not with everything in his amendment. It's not to say, that, of course, that there are not genuine concerns. Last week at Topical Questions, I highlighted the government's decision to abolish the Board of Experts tasked with overseeing introduction of the named person. Ministers did not see fit to inform Parliament of their intention, nor even to tell us they had done it. That was, I think, both high-handed and disrespectful. Practically, of course, the way in which the named person is introduced and resourced matters greatly. During the passage of the bill, like others, I highlighted the need to ensure that focus is not diverted away from those cases where there are genuine welfare concerns at stake. It is something that the Deputy Chief Constable raised in the now abolished Programme Board, and it is probably the area where most work is needed to reassure the public, as well as those more directly involved in this process. The key to avoiding this happening is for the government to make sure it is properly resourced. In this respect, I think the criticism contained in the Labour's amendment does have some merit, reflecting concerns of the RCN, teaching unions, and indeed local authorities reiterated yesterday in the Education Committee. Moreover, the government was wrong, I think, not to limit the scope of the named person provision to those 16 and under, or to introduce a presumption in favour of explicit consent for information sharing. Both have made implementing this measure, as well as reassuring the public, more problematic. Notwithstanding those concerns, though, I simply do not buy the argument about so-called state-sponsored guardians. Initially, I too, like I think the former Cabinet Secretary, viewed these proposals with a little scepticism. However, based on the evidence we heard in committee and discussions I've had with those involved in working with children, I've been persuaded that the named person can be made to work effectively and deliver benefits. We will need to keep a close eye on resourcing and ensure a ruthless focus is maintained on those in greatest need. But that is entirely possible and certainly not justification for the more dire predictions made by some. Personally, like others, I found the experience of those in Highland particularly helpful in coming to a view on this. The Gurfick pilot taken forward by Highland Council and its partners in the health, police and other services saw the idea of a named person first emerge, at the behest, it would appear, of parents keen to have a single point of contact. We would all subscribe to the need for joined-up working between agencies when supporting our children and young people, whatever that support may be. If everyone is responsible, however, there is always the risk that no one actually takes responsibility, and this measure, I think, helps address that particular risk. And in terms of the practicalities, the arguments made by Aberlour and others in their briefing are interesting, as well as illustrating how senior teachers will simply not have the time to meddle where there is no need. They point out that most parents would expect senior staff to look out for their children. In effect, these proposals will codify best practice, albeit, as I acknowledged earlier, with a need for adequate resources. It is also expected that the communication will be dramatically more in the direction of parent to named person rather than the other way around. This may offer reassurances to those worried about the effect on the role of parents, reinforced by statutory guidance that makes clear that parents will retain control of the relationship. Parents will be able to complain about their named person, in some circumstances have a new named person assigned, where the relationship breaks down or there is a conflict of interest. A reasonable safeguard, and one I think sought by Liz Smith during the passage of the bill in committee. It is also helpful, I think, that the guidance sets out strict rules on what information, if any, is collected and shared by the named person. As I said earlier, I think ministers were wrong to reject my amendments on introducing a presumption in favour of explicit consent for information sharing. Obviously, there will be instances where this isn't practical, but those are rare. The principle of explicit consent, meantime, seemed to me to be one worth enshrining. But as the briefing from the Coalition of Charities makes clear, named persons will rarely proactively collect information about a child except when there are serious existing concerns. They will receive information from other professionals only where there is a particular concern about a child and will then decide if action needs to be taken. Again, this rather mirrors what we would expect to be happening already. Presiding Officer, there are legitimate anxieties about how the named person will work in practice. We in this Parliament and those most directly affected by the Act's implementation will need to be alive to these. However, some of the intemperate language being used and characterisations made about what the named person approach is and what it will mean for children, young people and parents in Scotland are wide of the mark and irresponsible. For the vast majority, the truth is they may notice very little difference at all. Where it should deliver most benefit, however, is in directing vulnerable families to the help and support they need, and more particularly, as Ian Gray rightly pointed out, in allowing early identification of potential problems for those who may be at risk, ensuring help is provided that may well prevent more long-lasting problems emerging over time. Presiding Officer, the rollout of the named person must be proportionate and sensitive, but I believe that it can be an effective means of underpinning children's rights in Scotland, and that is something I very much support. Thank you.
Very much. Very tight for time today. Speeches up to 6 minutes, please. Mr Brodie to be followed by Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I suppose in this debate I have some experience as a parent of, or step-parent of, 5 children and 10 grandchildren, and because of my soft nature, they receive the fiercest of protection and the best of guidance. However, when I spoke in the child sexual exploitation abuse debate 2 years ago, I said that nothing can be more important than the welfare and protection of every child, but certainly those who are the most vulnerable in our society, children who need the greatest of care and support. Something with which we can agree, and I can assure you that the inquiry of the Petitions Committee in that debate burns a hole in me to this day. It is, of course, not unusual, Presiding Officer, that when a new legislation is introduced, there is the inevitability of differing opinions across parties, across the political spectrum, across ideals, and in this case, that is so. Just as in the debate before I mentioned it at the beginning, there are the overriding issues of children and the attendant emotions, all of which I thought I knew were embraced by Liz Smith. I'm sure they are in this, in how she feels, but unusually in this motion and speech was wrapped in unnecessary scaremongering. And because of these compelling emotions, some may have had concerns. But the basis of the policy of any new proposal, any service, change can only be validated by persuasion, by implementation, and above all, by evidence. And perhaps it is on that paradigm that those vehemently opposed to the policy in this chamber and beyond, and recognising the basis for emotion involved, might have worked out how they might work more constructively and accept eventually the intent and the evidence. So let's put down a marker and progress from there, Presiding Officer. Let us make it clear from the start. The named person role does not replace or change the role of a parent or carer, nor does it undermine families. Fundamentally, children and parents have no obligation to use the service. But where applicable, to children and parents who wish to take up the advice if offered. In a question raised by Liz Smith on the 16th of February this year, she asked if parents will have a legal right to withdraw their children from the provisions of the Children and Young People Act in relation to named persons. The answer, there will be no. There will be no legal obligations for families to engage with a named person if they choose not to. But that because the named person will be someone from the family knows and trusts that they may seek advice and support if they need it. Should it be otherwise? So when the motion calls for the growing opposition to the named person policy and there is strong criticism has been levelled at the policy by professionals, where is the significant growing opposition, apart from in pages 8 or 10 of the right-wing press? Are we honestly saying that organisations that have been mentioned before, from Aberlour to Bernardo, so who cares, are not professional when it comes to the care of those children that need it? And are we honestly saying that when the judicial review appeal was upheld in regard to the legality of the policy, Lord Calway It said, and I quote, the legislation was informed by views of experts. That's the same as professionals. Experts in child welfare, health and education. Its policy is to put the best interests of every child at the heart of decision making. And going on, said that the mere creation of a named person available if needed to assist a child or parent no more confuses or diminishes the legal role, duties and responsibilities of those parents. Presiding officer, I believe that this motion presented by Liz Smith was, you know, driven by the best of motives until she spoke. So given what I've said, we need to let the professionals work together to secure early interventions on child welfare, to prevent tragedies. And it is relevant that non-statutory versions of the named person role is already evident in areas like Edinburgh, Angus, Falkirk, Fife and Ayrshire. And as mentioned, the Highland Council implementation of the named person provision in 2010, a provision that was welcomed at the time by Liz Smith and Mary Scanlon in a previous Girfec debate, wherein she said, I'm particularly pleased to welcome the report on the results of the Girfec debate, developing a more holistic approach to the needs of the child. Presiding officer, inevitable, I suppose, that the motion states that extensive costs and bureaucracy will be involved in the implementation of the policy. It wouldn't be a Tory motion otherwise. As the Highland experience points out, it need not be so. And Martin Crewe of Bernardo's averred that neither of these criticisms is justified. Protection of the most vulnerable, particularly vulnerable children, is the responsibility of this chamber. We should secure that based on evidence and respect of the child.
Thanks so much. Now Colin Murdo-Fraser to be followed by Mark MacDonald. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I start this debate mindful of the instruction we had at the start not to make direct reference to the current court proceedings, although I notice that the Scottish Government's own amendment says this. It notes that the legal challenge to these provisions has now been rejected by the Scottish courts twice. I would say very gently to the Scottish Government, just because a policy isn't illegal doesn't make it sensible. Now, I don't think there's anyone in this debate who has a problem with the principle that children who are in a vulnerable situation need additional support. That is a principle that underlines Girfec, a principle I think supported by every party represented in this chamber. The issue that divides us is whether that approach should be extended to all children or simply those in a vulnerable situation. It is the universality of the named person policy that makes it controversial, and precisely why we are bringing this debate to Parliament this afternoon. Yes, of course.
Are you defining a vulnerable child? Is this somebody who's going to be a deserving poor, undeserving poor, the scroungers or skivers, the rhetoric, the language that you as often talk in?
Well, I really think that intervention by the Minister is beneath her. And I think when she reflects on that after this debate, she realises that sort of language is entirely unhelpful to the debate we're having this afternoon. I'm going to talk a little bit about resources, and I'll develop this argument, because it's actually an important one. Liz Smith talked about the additional burden put on public authorities through making this policy universal. This is a view expressed by the EIS. They've expressed concern about the impact on education, saying in July, and I quote, "Teachers are becoming increasingly concerned about the demands likely to be made of them, which will have implications for workload and potentially for conditions of service." Carol Ford, the former president of School Leaders Scotland, told the Scotsman in October that this policy will have, and I quote, "simply diminish the time and attention paid to those children who need it most. By spreading the named person resource across all children, most of whom have absolutely no need of it, rather than just those identified as vulnerable, the impact will be so thin as to be negligible. A named person should be identified only for those children who need it." And just today, in a press release from the Royal College of Nursing in Scotland, they continue to express their concerns about the resources in some areas to support the introduction of the named person. And this is where the crux of the issue comes, because for years we on this side of the chamber have been calling for proper resources for a universal health visiting service. Now, if you want to identify the people who are in need of support, you fund health visitors. And instead of putting the money into a named person policy that there's always criticism of in relation to a diversion of resources, put the money into health visitors. Well, yes, if the Minister will be slightly more careful in her choice of language, I will give way to her.
Mr. Aileen Campbell.
I still don't think he ever gave us an answer as to how he was going to determine what a vulnerable person is. I just wonder whether the member would welcome the announcement of 500 additional health visitors.
Murdo Fraser.
Yeah, and the Minister knows we are on record as welcoming that, but of course that is precisely how we identify the vulnerable children, by having the health visitors, which is why we want to see the resources going into the named person policy rolled out into that much more useful way of addressing this particular issue. But the more concerning the implication for resources is the fear that this legislation will undermine parental rights. Now, we've heard lots of assertion today in this debate from SNP members that this will not happen. I just want to quote to them a number of people who take a contrary view, including the Scottish Parent Teacher Council, who've said, "We believe the concept of a named person for every child is ill thought through and offers no benefit to the majority of children whose named person is already in place, their parent or carer. Yeah. For most children in receipt of universal services, their parent or carer is the person who has the most interest in their well-being, knows them best, is committed, has staying power and is most committed to ensure the health, education and other services they come into contact deliver for them. This proposal completely fails to recognise that significant relationship and the fact that it seeks to usurp the role of the parent." Yeah. Not the words of Conservative members in this Parliament, the role of the Scottish Parent Teacher Council. And similar concerns have been raised by Maggie Mellon, who the Minister will well know, a social worker for over 35 years and Vice Chair of the British Association of Social Workers. And she said, "The exclusion of parents and families seems to be based on a misunderstanding or misinterpretation or what is meant by child-centred practice, which assumes that the government can and should have a direct relationship with children, bypassing or ignoring their parents and families. But children live in families, not idealised families and not demonised families, just families, with all their complexities and their occasional failings and crises, but for most children, the best for them to be is to be the people who care about them most in the world." Who could disagree with that? Not the words of Conservatives, by any stretch of the imagination, but the role of experts in the field. And as the parent of two young children at primary school, I can identify with those remarks. If somebody is to have primary responsibility for my children's welfare, it should be me, or at least their mother. It should be us as parents who have these responsibilities, not someone nominated by the state. It is an intrusion into family life and the primary responsibility of parents for the state to seek to usurp the parental role. Now, on the Scottish Government's website, there is a page named Top 10 Named Person Facts, aiming to dispel what it claims are myths around the policy. And this states that children and parents have no obligation to use this service or take up the advice or help offered.
Please.
Liz Smith has pointed out, this is not the case. We know that professionals believe that it is their position to take an interventionist approach, and it will be flagged up as a risk indicator if there is parental resistance or even limited engagement for the role of a named person.
Thanks very much, Mr. Fraser, this is a misguided policy
at best. It is dangerous. It will have a negative impact on resources better spent elsewhere. The government should think again.
Thank you. Yeah. Can I now call on Mark MacDonald to be followed by Mark Griffin, please?
I guess, presiding officer, it's an occasional occupational hazard of politics that occasionally we lapse into hyperbolic statements and over-the-top narrative. But I have to say, first and foremost, as somebody who's known Ruth Davidson for close on 17 years, I was extremely disappointed in the remarks that she made in the press at the weekend. And the reason why I found it very disappointing is, first and foremost, because it's always disappointing when somebody who you get on quite well with says something quite so outrageous. But secondly, if we look, for example, at the case of Daniel Pelka and the review into the death of Daniel Pelka, which said, "Some of the failings in this case related to systems not working effectively rather than simply to individual errors, because opportunities were sometimes missed by practitioners to intervene more effectively or to apply a greater child focus to interventions." And that then led to Anne Houston, the former chief executive of Children First, who I think most people in this chamber would accept as somebody who speaks with a great deal of authority on these matters, to state, "Deaths like Daniel's remind us why the principle behind the named person in the Children and Young People Bill is a sound one, as it aims to prevent children slipping through the net." Now, nobody in this chamber in any way, shape or form would suggest that there is never going to be something happen in the future, that you could absolutely categorically legislate to completely prevent a tragedy from occurring. But what you can do is you can legislate to make it less likely, and you can legislate to remove some of the gaps that exist where services don't always communicate effectively, where there isn't always that, that roundtable approach to ensuring the welfare of children. And I looked at the briefing that was sent to us, and I looked at the organisations who have chosen to write to us and put their organisations' names to a briefing in support of named persons. And Liz Smith cited some of them: Aberlour, Action for Children, Bernardo's, Celsus, Children First, Children in Scotland, One Parent Family Scotland, all coming forward and speaking in favour of the named person approach. And Liz Smith said in her opening remark that because these organisations are organisations who work with the most vulnerable children in Scotland, that somehow rendered the universal application of the named person policy as wrong-headed. And I say to Liz Smith, it is her analysis of this that is wrong-headed, because if you look at the fact that these organisations are writing in support of it, if they thought for 1 second, just 1 second, that the introduction of this policy would result in resources being diverted from the most vulnerable children in society or lead to those children becoming more at risk than less at risk, they would oppose it in a heartbeat. You can be guaranteed of that. And what it clearly demonstrates by these organisations taking the time to write to us and express their support for the policy is that they recognise the benefits that it will bring, and they understand that the named person policy, 1 second, the named person policy is about supporting children who, as Bernardo's identify in their briefings to us, in many ways the child most at risk is the one who has not yet been identified as being at risk. I'll take her
next question.
I thank the member for giving way. If it's the case that the Scottish Government is saying that in the vast majority of cases the named person will no longer be necessary, will never be necessary, why do we need them in the first place?
Well, Donald, if she'd listened to the first 2.5 minutes of my speech, where I outlined the point in relation to the Daniel Pelka case, and which could be equally applied to many other cases of tragic circumstances where there was not the required communication between the relevant organisations, and the supportive remarks from Anne Houston of Children First, she would have known better than to offer me such a specious intervention at this stage of the debate. But to go beyond that, to the nub of this, the reality, and I think it was highlighted in the in Murdo Fraser's speech, where he spoke of the idea of parents being usurped. Well, I'm a parent. I'm a parent of a child with a disability. I'm a parent of a child without a disability. I see no threat to my role as a parent from the named person policy. Maybe I just have a different view of that from Murdo Fraser. But the most interesting thing was where Murdo Fraser said that the way that you deal with this is through investment in health visiting, and health visiting alone. And I welcome the announcement for the Minister around the additional health visitors that are going to be funded. I also accept that there is a role for health visitors within the named person provision, up to a point. Because the idea that Murdo Fraser is propagating when he speaks about health visitors being the sole solution in all of this is that a child can be identified at risk at the point of birth, and at no point during that child's transition through childhood into adolescence can that child go from not being a child at risk to being a child at risk. There are no circumstances that could lead to that, and that to me is fundamentally misguided in taking that approach, because there are a range of external factors that can influence what happens in that child's life, and if the only eggs that you put in the basket are at the very beginning of that child's existence, you run the risk of missing later on. Because it is not so simple as to be able to point to an individual child and say that that child is at risk. A child from a comfortable background is just, in terms of finance, is just as likely to potentially be in a household where the mother has postnatal depression, as happened in my own household, where my wife went through a period of postnatal depression. You would have perhaps looked at our household and not necessarily identified us as being in a position where that might have arisen, but that did arise nonetheless. So we can never categorically say child will ever require a named person simply on the basis of an arbitrary factor. It cannot be determined so easily. That's why the policy is correct. It's why the Conservatives are so wide of the mark.
Thanks very much. Now call on Mark Griffin to be followed by Mike Russell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Government has our considered support in this debate, but there are
real perils ahead as the policy process turns from sweeping objectives to tangible delivery. I would like to thank the Scottish Government for publishing the revised draft statutory guidance yesterday, which has helped to clear up some, if not all, of the confusion surrounding these proposals. And I think we can all agree that children and families having an easily identified advocate on their behalf is a positive step. And indeed, as has been widely stated by the broad coalition within Civic Scotland who support these aims, a large number of the functions of the named persons are already being carried out. Teachers, guidance counsellors and health visitors are working tirelessly to support families as we debate today and will continue to do so under the new legislation. Now, the rhetoric from the government is difficult to disagree with. Getting it right for every child is a venerable ideal. We all want Scotland to be the best place in the world to grow up, and every child and young person in Scotland has the right to play, to be healthy and happy, to learn new things and to be looked after and nurtured. The challenge for the government, though, is in realising these laudable aims and bridging the gap between broad sweeping statements of intent and delivering on the infrastructure, resources and support which are necessary. Now, one of the last major policy initiatives which began with a similar level of support was Curriculum for Excellence. There was broad support for the aims and objectives of the policy, which commanded support across the board in public life in Scotland. Unfortunately, that support faded and problems grew as the date of implementation approached and difficulties of delivery became apparent. Ever the optimist, though, I'm sure that the Scottish Government has listened to the concerns raised regarding the draft guidance and will address them thoroughly. Yep, certainly.
Minister Aileen McLeod.
It's a genuine point I think the member will welcome around us providing support for parents. He may welcome the fact that we have launched guidance that was in BSL.
Yep, certainly that's a personal campaign of mine. I thank the Minister for taking the needs of BSL using parents into account. That guidance is crucial because it will directly impact the local implementation, which could be a defining factor in whether this policy aids families. It would be helpful if the Minister could reassure us over some of the weaknesses which still persist in the government's approach and how she intends to tackle them. And it's not just members in this Parliament she must reassure, it's the thousands of education and health workers who will be required to implement the new scheme. I have three main areas of concern which remain. Firstly, the Royal College of Nursing have already highlighted that there is a shortage of health visitors. Teachers and health visitors are going to be expected to carry out their named person role on top of their usual duties with no extra resources. Head teachers could easily end up being the named person to several hundreds of pupils in particular areas. And any suggestion that these changes don't add to existing workloads is simply untenable. The practical challenges of availability due to teaching commitments, time pressures, recruitment challenges and the resources to provide training will all fall on local authorities and health boards with no extra financial support. Secondly, and at the heart of the changes, the definition of wellbeing is vague and undefined, and that's open to a wide range of interpretation. That remains the case despite yesterday's attempt to add clarity and despite being a key tenet of the new approaches. It's still without clear and unambiguous guidance. The government has tried to flesh this out with the Plenary acronym Safe, Healthy, Achieving, Nurtured, Active, Respected, Responsible and Included, but the EIS have pointed out that it may lead to a skewed and overly simplistic impression that the well-being of children from more affluent backgrounds is secure, while children who are from less affluent backgrounds are likely to present with well-being concerns. It's hard to disagree, and unfortunately we have to view that test in the wider context of poverty, of pockets of poverty. Should the named person be a head teacher of a school in an area with higher levels of deprivation, we might not be able to help but find a blanket failure to meet that test. Finally, Presiding Officer, there remains an issue around children's services plans, which will be provided by local authorities and health boards. It's my understanding these will be signed off by ministers, but is that the end of the role the Scottish Government will play if the children's services plans state that there's a lack of resourcing? Will there be support available? How do they interact with the individual child's plan? How are local authorities meant to meet the conflicting demands of the individual and the collective availability of support? Presiding Officer, I think there's a lot of work to be done between now and the end of August next year to convince families, health and educational professionals and all those who support the employment policy that the Government is capable of steering and crucially resourcing this policy to a successful outcome. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Very tight for time. Mike Russell to be followed by Malcolm Chisholm. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I haven't spoken on an education and childcare debate in this chamber for over a year. In fact, and I checked it since the 20th of November last year when I answered a question on the training of educational psychologists from my friend David Stewart. That's not evidence of a lack of interest. I remain passionately interested in all aspects of education and childcare, and indeed remain, as ex-ministers do, fascinated about almost all of the subjects I dealt with in government. It's always best to let one's successors act and be heard without noises off from the past, but I'm speaking here today with the agreement of my successor and the Minister for Children, with whom I had the pleasure of working on this issue. And I'm speaking because I want to publicly and clearly raise my voice against the Tory motion and what the highly regrettable and utterly misplaced Tory campaign against the named person policy. I have some admiration for Liz Smith. She knows a great deal about education, though my saying so will not probably help her street cred in Tory streets at least. But I believe she's profoundly wrong about this issue, and I have to regret the way in which she is raising it. It will encourage the worst of responses from some people, and has already done so from her leader, whose publicity at the weekend on the matter was misleading, misinformed, and most alarmingly at all, will be maliciously misused by others. I want to speak about principle and practice this afternoon. I want to pay tribute to the three ministers who have made this positive policy possible. The current minister, Aileen Campbell, her maternity leave cover, Fiona MacLeod, and her predecessor, Adam Ingram. All three are highly thought of in the sector. All three have passionately believed in and implemented this important innovation. And they've done so hand in hand with all the main children's charities, with local authorities, with health, social work and justice professionals, with the police and with countless others, including Labour. And I commend at least three quarters of the speech by Ian Gray this afternoon. And all this proves, and it's the central point, that the named person initiative as part of GIRFEC isn't an extreme or experimental policy. It's a mainstream, respected and effective approach to supporting and helping children, parents and families. And by so doing, it supports and helps our society. It's also been supported to date by a judgment and an appeal judgment in the courts. And the principle is clear and positive. It's the named person is intended to act as a point of contact. That's what it is. It absolutely does not supplant or replace parental concern, love, affection, support, responsibility or guidance. It does not. I give way.
Smith.
I thank the member for giving way, and it's good to hear him speak again on this subject. Could I ask him what it was that made him change his mind, given that he himself said in this chamber that he was rather nervous about the named person policy?
If she will wait, that will come in a moment, because I want to address that point, because I did become a strong convert for this policy. Now, this is not a policy that produces a state guardian in any recognisable use or meaning of the term. And Liam MacArthur confirmed this afternoon that understanding, and he sat through all the evidence. There isn't, and there will be no state guardian, no usurping of parental role, no demonisation of parents. All that language is, as the facts demonstrate, untrue spin, designed to undermine the delivery of necessary and appropriate support to children. And I believe no MSP should be complicit in that spin. Jackie Brock had put it well when she defined the named person in much simpler language as a primary point of contact available to all children. And she went on to observe that it's often merely the formalisation of practice that already exists. And she also noted that the policy and the legislation has grown from a sincere commitment to improve children's welfare and protecting families. It's light touch assistance, it's appropriate assistance, it's assistance where and when needed. It's assistance that can be crucial sometimes because it is light touch. Two examples, Presiding Officer. The first from my very first week in office, almost 6 years ago. I went to Fort William to see the Gurfic pilot in operation, and it was working because it was coordinating the work of others, it was light touch, and it was meaning that young children and young people, often from very chaotic backgrounds, were able to be helped and guided in a supportive way through the Named Person Programme. No wonder Mary Scanlon spoke warmly of the Named Person Programme in the Highland region. The pilot programme worked and worked spectacularly. And then later on, I went to see in a school, in actual fact, in Liz Smith's area, not Forfar, but somewhere else. I went to see in a school how it was working because I remained concerned because there were noises off. And I met a young boy, and it stayed with me ever since. This young boy, his mother had died, and his father went to pieces. And the child was in real difficulty, but he had a named person. And he was able to go to that named person and, again, with the lightest of touches, get the support he needed to support his father, to support the family, and to keep the family together without the intervention of social workers or others. It worked for him. And that's the boy we should think about today. That young man persuaded me, finally, that this was the right thing. It is the right thing. And the wrong thing is to take this and attempt to play to a political gallery. I understand that the Tories want to be the second party in Scotland. That's their business. But I want to make sure that the first party in Scotland is delivering for Scotland's children. By all means, divide this chamber on matters of genuine principle, but don't divide us on our shared concern for children, our shared support for children, and our shared desire to encourage good family life in Scotland. The named person helps, doesn't hinder that.
Thanks so much. Now Colin Malcolm Chisholm, to be followed by Nigel Dawn.
Sir, at this stage in the process, we ought to be concentrating on the implementation of the named person policy, and clearly I welcome what Ian Gray said about that at the beginning. But the sad reality is that we still have to address the myths and the scaremongering that have stirred up a great deal of anxiety and misunderstanding among certain people. I suppose I should acknowledge the relatively measured tones of the motion and the relatively restrained tones of Liz Smith's opening, but only relative to the disgraceful weekend hyperbole of her leader, which stood truth on its head. I mean, for me, the killer question in this debate is why on earth, if the fundamental critique that Ruth Davidson was making and that Liz Smith repeated today, that this policy puts certain vulnerable children at risk. Why on earth would every single organisation in Scotland that works for vulnerable children support this policy? And I've got such a long list of them here that it would take the rest of my speech to read it. So we have to address the anxieties and misunderstandings with simple, clear messages about the policy. I'll just give five. The idea for the named person originally came from parents, so that there could be a clear point of contact for support services. It involves a stronger role for an existing member of staff, not a new person, far less a state guardian. There were no powers in the named person legislation to force a child or a family to do anything. It's based on existing practice, and Edinburgh and Highland I'll mention briefly if I've got time. And finally, social work as a targeted service is only involved when needed. And I've got a long quote here, but I'll only read the last sentence of it from Alistair Gow, who's the president of Social Work Scotland, whose conclusion is, the named person role will reduce, not increase, the involvement of social work in the lives of family, protecting resources for our most vulnerable children. So I hope Ruth Davidson reads that particular quote. And Liz Smith was also concerned about the universal nature of services. But as Bernardo said in the briefing that they sent us yesterday, I quote, it is essential to have a universal early warning system to identify the children who are most vulnerable. In many ways, the child most at risk is the one who has not yet been identified. So this is about supporting and safeguarding. It's about enhancing the rights of children while respecting those of parents. In the vast majority of cases, as the more general briefing we got today from a whole range of children's organisations pointed out, the traffic will flow from the named person to a parent, and as they also pointed out, there are strict rules about what information is collected or shared. So I think that some of these basic facts about the named person, we just have to repeat them, you know, the way that politicians do, and sometimes we're criticised, but there is a good reason for just repeating things over and over again, because these things have not been taken in by a lot of people because of the massive scale of the distortion and vilification of this policy. I've never read so many ridiculously absurd articles on any subject in recent times than I have on the named person. I sort of printed off a whole collection for this debate, and I despaired, but decided, well, we just have to challenge it. Now, I suppose one reason why I do feel strongly about this is because we've had this policy in Edinburgh since 2009, and has any parent ever come to me complaining about it? November 2009, policy document, City of Edinburgh Council. One aim of GIRFECT is to move towards earlier intervention and quicker identification of needs. We will achieve this by introducing the role of the named person. So that was happening in Edinburgh. As is even better known, it was happening in Highland as part of the Pathfinder. And Liz Smith asked, where is the evidence that the named person had anything to do with the success of the Pathfinder? Well, I refer Liz Smith to the post Pathfinder submission completed by Bill Alexander, Director of Health and Social Care, on the 13th of September 2013. I can't read it all out in the minute and a half that's left to me. I'll summarise. I'll take a few sentences. Critically, the named person is a point of contact for families. We know that. If the family wish, the named person can request help from other agencies. If other professionals have concerns about child's well-being, rather than rushing to social worker, police or a host of other agencies, the concern can be passed to the named person. And this is interesting, skipping a bit because I've no time. He says, previous to the named person policy, the children's hearing system was becoming deluged and swamped by inappropriate referrals and unnecessary processes, preventing and delaying the system from responding to those children who may actually have been in need of compulsory measures. The development of the named person role was widely welcomed in Highland and has been fully implemented since 2010. Families prefer having contact with someone they already know and who knows the child. And so on it goes. It's all there in a lot more detail than that. So it is standing truth on its head. Actually, this allows us to A, identify vulnerable children better, actually spend more time on them, contrary to what Ruth Davidson said. And there are just... Well, I'll
Members
give
finishing now. Members closing.
I can't accept the intervention. So I really think the implementation issues are what we should be concentrating on. Included, there are issues in terms of getting the message across and providing the resources that are needed. But we still have to do this fundamental task of supporting the policy, basically, and challenging the misrepresentation of that policy. And I have a high regard, like Mike Russell,
close,
Smith,
please.
But I do regret the speech that she made today.
Many thanks. We're now completely out of time. The last four speakers have to reduce to 5.5 minutes each. Mr. Dawn, to be followed by Neil Bibby. 5.5 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I would like to take the opportunity of taking the Chamber back to the Children and Young People Scotland Act as passed. Firstly, Section 19(5) of the Act provides that a named person's functions are, and I'm picking these out from several different lines, quotes, advising, informing or supporting the child, young person or parent, helping them access a service or support, and discussing or raising a matter about them with a service provider or relevant authority, close quote. The Health Board is to appoint the named person for a preschool child, and the local authority takes over once they go to school. That's Section 20. Sections 21 to 23 helpfully speak about communication under different circumstances, the whole point being that information about vulnerable children should not get lost. And I would ask the Chamber to note the effect of Section 23(4) that, in considering whether information ought to be provided, the outgoing service provider, who's providing it to something else, somebody else taking over, is so far as is reasonably practical, to ascertain and have regard to the views of the child or the young person. This is mirrored in Section 25(5), And again, please note that Section 25(7) requires that information ought to be provided only if the likely benefit to the well-being of the child or young person arising in consequence of doing so outweighs any likely adverse effect on that well-being arising from doing so. A named person must also act according to the Scottish Minister's guidance, that's Section 28, and directions, that's Section 29. The practice briefing note of December 2010, which provided the guidance, is very clear about the purpose of the named person. It says it is a named person's responsibility to take action to provide help or arrange for the right help to be provided to promote the child's development and well-being. All questions are to be considered about well-being and what can be done to help, respecting confidentiality and I quote, children and families must always give permission for information to be shared. During pregnancy and immediately after birth, the named person should be a midwife, thereafter a health visitor, and in time, a member of school staff. Now, I've drawn the chamber back to the original documents here, presiding officer, just to put it all back in that original guiding context. Can I make the point that whatever Scottish ministers might put in guidance and direction, it cannot exceed what is in the original Act? It certainly cannot push the boundaries of that. Furthermore, in the guidance, it says that taking action in different circumstances, in every circumstance, it's critical that children and family are involved in discussions, the gathering of information, and in decision-making. The essential point is that the legislation must be looked at overall, and the legal point is that the powers conferred by the statute can only lawfully be used for the purposes for which they are conferred and within the constraints placed upon them. I'm grateful to Mark MacDonald for picking up on some of the issues that Murdo Fraser raised, because whilst I can understand why Murdo, sadly, is not here, and many other members, well as parents, find it difficult to understand why parents might be regarded as any kind of problem. Can I say, I think this is probably the Scottish Parent Teacher Council is made up of parents who would not be a problem. Understandably, forgive me, I know Murdo is here. Those are precisely the kind of parents who I suspect would not be a problem at all and do feel that they might be usurped. But could we just be absolutely clear that there are occasions when parents are a problem? Mark MacDonald also helpfully made the point that it's not just in the very early years that vulnerability arises or could conceivably be identified, and expecting health visitors to be the only source of that is, I would suggest, unreasonable. It is fundamentally, presiding officer, that there should be somebody who can see the wider picture at whatever age, somebody to whom everybody who has a concern can turn to, and somebody therefore who has a chance of making sure that some of the dreadful, albeit rare, cases that we have seen have a chance of not being repeated. And on that basis, presiding officer, I think it will turn out to be a very good thing, and I have very little doubt that it will stand the test of time. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Appreciate your brevity. Now call on Neil Bibby to be followed by Animal Goldie. Up 5.5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There can be no higher priority for all of us here in this chamber than to ensure our child protection systems work and protect vulnerable children from abuse or neglect. We all know that, sadly, there have been far too many high-profile cases of child neglect over the years which have not been identified or acted upon by the authorities until it was too late. Serious case reviews like the tragic Declan Haney case have demonstrated major failings and blame when no one person or agency has taken responsibility for a child's welfare. I've said before in this chamber that I do not believe it's the state's job to bring up all children, but as Ian Gray and others have said, I do not believe that this is the intention of the policy. Given this, I do support in principle the named person role to ensure children are protected from neglect or abuse. My own son is 5 months old, and since he was born, my wife and I have received important support and advice from our health visitor. We have found the health visitor to be helpful, not intrusive. And I do not fear that health visitor becoming a named person. But we do have to recognise that there are genuine concerns from parents about the named person role which have not been addressed. As Ian Gray said, I do believe the Minister and the Government are trying to do the right thing, but if those concerns have been acted upon and responded to properly when the Children and Young People Bill was being debated, then I don't think we would be in the situation we are now, where there is an impression that this policy seeks to provide a social worker for every child or replace the role of parents. One area in particular of the legislation that is still deeply flawed is the named person provision for 16 to 18-year-olds. During the passage of the bill, Labour and others supported amendments on reducing the age limit for having a named person from 18 to 16. We did this because we listened to what experts like Bill Alexander, who has already been quoted this afternoon, had said, the Director of Care of Learning at Highland Council, said at the time. I remember when he gave evidence to the committee, many of us were concerned when he questioned why a named person would be needed for most children who had left school. He said, I do not understand how my daughter is 17 and doing performing arts in Manchester could have a named person. She will not need one or want one. There is no doubt that some young people will require additional support after leaving school. However, the vast majority of young people will neither nor want a named person. As members have said, the Highland Council was the national pathfinder for implementing GIRFIC, and Bill Alexander is highly respected in this Parliament. In fact, during stage one of the Children and Young People Bill, I remember Mike Russell actually said Bill Alexander knows more about this subject than anyone else, and I found what he said to be true. Yeah, take a brief intervention.
Mary Scanlon.
Thank you. I appreciate that. As a Highlands and Islands MSP since 1999, can I also say that you cannot simply look at the GIRFIC. NHS Highland and Highland Council were also the pioneers of the lead agency model for health and social care. Therefore, Highland Council are fully responsible for all aspects of all care and all education of children under 16. That's got nothing to do with the named person.
Well, I think we need to revisit the issue of the named person for 16 to 18-year-olds. And given this, I still find it astonishing that the Scottish Government proceeded without listening to what people such as Bill Alexander and opposition parties said about this particular issue. And I have to say to the SNP Government's failure to listen and insisting that 16 to 18-year-olds will have a named person is a ridiculous position to take. It is ludicrous that a young person can join the army and yet still have a named person. We can't logically say that 16 to 18-year-olds can have a vote, but they still need a named person. But this unfortunately detracts from the whole named person policy, and even those who support it in principle. And even now, I would advise the Minister to rethink this aspect of the legislation. Such a move, I'm sure, would be welcomed and show that the Government and the Minister are listening. There are still major concerns from professionals about its implementation, resources and the additional burdens of staff, which I and others raised when the bill was passed. Our position on resources is the same as the Child Protection Charity for the NSPCC, who said NSPCC Scotland supports the intention behind the named person approach, which, if properly resourced, could increase the likelihood of early intervention for children and young people, thus improving their outcomes. The key phrase here, of course, is properly resourced. It's clear to anyone, and we have to recognise, this policy will not work properly unless it is properly resourced. We also need to listen to people like Theresa Fife, Director of the RCN in Scotland, who gave a warning earlier this year. She said, we welcome the Scottish Government's commitment to recruiting more health visitors, but with the named person responsibility coming on top of recent changes to the workload of health visitors, many of our health visitor members have deep concerns that even with the planned boost in numbers, there just won't be enough hours in the day to fulfil the important role.
Please.
We need to listen to what the RCN are saying, what the EIS are saying, and what other professionals are saying. In closing, Presiding Officer, nearly all the points I've raised today, I raised in a speech nearly 2 years ago during the Children and Young People Bill. I hope the Government and the Minister will respond to the concerns that have been raised swiftly and positively to them.
Thanks so much. Now call on Annabel Goldie to be followed by Gordon MacDonald. Up to 5.5 minutes, please.
Deputy Presiding Officer, some may argue that as the policy of named persons is now enshrined in statute, the train has left the station and is now clattering down the rails. But this is a controversial measure, and it's the duty of this Parliament to monitor the progress of the train and indeed consider whether it should slow down, take a different route, or pause in a siding. And that assessment requires constant questioning of the Government about progress. Now, for example, it came to light that the Scottish Government had abolished the Expert Programme Board, which had been advising the Government on Guirfeach. I appreciate the National Implementation Support Group remains, but there is a lack of transparency about what advice the government has been receiving, because none of it has been published. Although late yesterday afternoon we had a flurry of Scottish Government activity with the publication of final draft guidance. Quite amazing what an opposition debate can trigger. Now, we do know that an assistant chief constable at the penultimate meeting of the programme board in May 2014 raised the issue of ensuring high-risk children remain a focus when this legislation takes effect. And that's why an absence of transparency about where we are is troubling. And this debate is timely and has presented a useful opportunity both to remind Parliament of and for Parliament to discuss the strong criticism the policy faces from professionals, a criticism that may be unwelcome to the Scottish Government, but they nonetheless need to listen to it, because these are the people who are likely to be at the front line of delivering as the date for implement edges closer. Now, the principle of Guirfeach, of course, finds support across this chamber, but the universality of the named person legislation has raised both philosophical and practical challenges. And let me articulate the concerns of others, not the concerns articulated by me or my party, but independently by other groups. The executive director of the Scottish Parent Teacher Council, Ellen Pryor, said in an interview with Holyrood magazine only last month, that, and I quote, named person, in her view, is a red herring, which will undermine trust and cause issues between families, schools or other professionals, divert resources from those families most in need, add to professionals' workload and lead to more families being drawn into the system unnecessarily. Now, if that is so, Deputy Presiding Officer, then I think there's a risk that children will be hesitant to access confidential services. And that point was argued by the children's legal charity Clan Child Law in May, who said of this policy, and I quote, it creates a serious risk that children and young people will not access confidential services when they are in need of help. Indeed, that undermining of trust in professionals may also affect families. If families are fearful that if they are open about the problems they face or the support they think they need, then they may worry that that information could be shared in a way prejudicial to them. And the next problem surrounds the extensive costs, practical consequences and the bureaucracy necessary for implementation of the policy. Ian Gray, although I did not agree with everything he said, made some hard-hitting points, because the Scottish Government presumes that for the majority of children of school age, the named person will be a teacher. Yet teachers already face substantial workload pressures. The Association of Head Teachers and Deputies warned in February that they were, and I quote, very concerned about the workload this might generate, and said this had to be addressed before commencement. And this was echoed in the summer by the EIS, who argued, and I quote, the default position should not be assumed that a school should always be expected to provide the named person irrespective of its capacity and resource. Now, Deputy Presiding Officer, these are real concerns, because we do have some information about Guirfeach costs for 2016-17. And it shows that over a third of these, almost £10 million, will fall to local authorities already under budget pressures. And in the same year, Guirfeach will cost the NHS over £16 million, which leads me to quote from the Director of the Royal College of Nursing, who said earlier this year, many of their health visitor numbers have deep concerns that even with the planned boost in numbers, there just won't be enough hours in the day to carry out named persons' duties. I'm very tight for time, Mr. MacDonald. I'm sorry, I planned this in 6 minutes and I've been cut back. But can I lastly, Deputy Presiding Officer, turn to a very important point? The very nature of the named person legislation means that it does flood the system with many children who do not need to be there. Now, ministers can deny that until the cows come home, but it is an incontrovertible arithmetical fact. And that does place vulnerable, at-risk children in a difficult position. It does. And that's exactly the point made by the Assistant Chief Constable, Malcolm Graham, at the penultimate meeting of the Guirfeach Programme Board in May 2014, when he said there was an issue surrounding ensuring high-risk children remained a focus. If he didn't think that was an issue, why did he say that? So I have to say, Deputy Presiding Officer, there are concerns. We need more information. And I think that to address the growing opposition and deep concerns of many families and professionals, the Scottish Government must provide answers and transparency. It's unacceptable to leave people in the dark. So in conclusion, as an immediate priority, will the Scottish Government at least publish all the advice it has received from the National Implementation Support Group?
Thanks very much. Now, invite Gordon MacDonald to make the final speech for the day, after which we move to closing speeches. 5.5 minutes, please, Mr MacDonald.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The named person policy has been tested across Scotland in a number of local authority areas, including Edinburgh, Fife, Angus, South Lanarkshire and Highland. Highland Council published their GIRFEC implementation plan in June 2006, and between 2006 and 2008, it was rolled out across the Highland area and fully implemented by early 2010. As Children in Scotland pointed out last year, every child in the Highland area already has a named person. The education information sheet produced by Highland Council, NHS Highland, Northern Constabulary and others back in 2009 about named person highlighted the key questions any person who works with children who has concerns that they might need additional support will ask themselves the five questions. What is getting in the way of this child's well-being? Do I have all the information I need to help this child? What can I do now to help this child? What can my agency do to help this child? And what additional help, if any, may be needed from other agencies? Fife Council identified at each stage of a young person's life the named person as either the hospital or community midwife, the health visitor, the primary head teacher, and at secondary, the guidance teacher, all of them professionals who have had an interest in our children's well-being for decades. As Bernardo Scotland said in a written submission, the named person is not a new person in a child's life, but merely a stronger role for an existing member of staff. Fife Council also stated that the named person role formalises the activities universal agencies are undertaking routinely in their day-to-day work, and continues, experience from the Pathfinders and learning partners has shown that, in spite of anxieties, the role of the named person has not created additional work. Rather, the new processes have sharpened existing roles. A review by Highland Council in September 2013, 3 years after it was fully implemented in the local authority area, found that for those children who need it, there is now a team in place around the child that works and plans together to ensure that the needs of the child are addressed appropriately. Professionals, the child and the family work better together to achieve the best possible outcome for the child, resulting in children in the Highland area being better supported to achieve, attain and to realise their potential and achieve positive destinations post-school. It's those positive findings by the Highland Council review that has led to many organisations working with children supporting the legislation. In a joint briefing from the 11 leading children's charities, they highlighted that the vast majority of children's charities and professional bodies working with children support the introduction of the named person. They also highlighted that the idea for the named person originally came from parents who expressed a desire to see access to support simplified and a single point of contact through which to access that support. The named person represents that single point of contact and effectively signposts state support and offer advice in times of difficulty. And they went on, the named person exists to direct vulnerable families to help and support. They will also have a coordinating role and will pull all of the threads of information together for a child about whom a worrying picture has begun to emerge. That's it. GIRFEC exists to ensure that there is always someone looking out for your child. This just standardises something that most parents would hope was happening already. Despite the support the policy has had with children's charities, councils and professionals, campaigners against the named person's legislation raised a legal challenge and lost. An appeal was lodged and a panel of three judges reconsidered the case and refused the appeal, stating that the legislation does not breach human rights or European Union law. And as the Minister has already said, in their judgment issued in September of this year, they stated the mere creation of a named person available to assist a child or parent no more confuses or diminishes the legal role, duties and responsibilities of parents in relation to their children than the provision of social services or education generally. It has no effect whatsoever on the legal, moral or social relationships within the family. The assertion to the contrary, without any supporting basis, has the appearance of hyperbole. Highland Council, who tested the legislation that helped frame the national guidance on the named person, stated at the time of the judgment being released, the named person service ensures that families with any concerns about their child's well-being know where to take that concern and that they get good advice and support. It is proven in practice, has been welcomed by parents, and I am pleased that the value of the named person role is reaffirmed by today's decision.
Many thanks. And we now move to the closing speeches, and I call on Cara Hilton. 6 minutes, up to 6 minutes, please, Ms Hilton.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. There's no doubt that the Scottish Government's named person policy is a controversial one, and I think that's largely due to the type of remarks that we've heard today from the Tory members and from the Tory tabloids, who take great pleasure in whipping up concerns and fear amongst parents about a policy which in reality is about protecting the rights of Scotland's children and about ensuring that we provide our most vulnerable families with the support they need when they need it. Members across the Chamber have highlighted examples of the fears that have been expressed and promoted, none of which are grounded in reality. The idea that there will somehow be a spy in every home checking what we let our kids watch on TV or what we give them for their tea, it's not only far-fetched, it is, as Ian Gray said earlier, complete nonsense. And Ian Gray's comparison with many of the scare stories we heard in the early days about Europe, with the myths circulating about has been forced to grow straight bananas and rename British sausages, is a great parallel for much of the debate we've seen around the named person policy. The reality is, as many members have highlighted today, the named person policy is not about undermining the role of parents or questioning their authority, and it's not about providing a social worker for every child, as the Daily Mail would have us believe. It's about ensuring that information is properly shared so that if and when issues appear in a child's life, teachers or health visitors who already have a duty of care towards our children and who already have a role in our children's lives are better able to support our children and better able to support families before problems become severe. And as members across the Chamber have said, in many respects, it's just about formalising an approach that's already tried, tested and working well in many local authorities such as Fife, Edinburgh and the Highlands, providing parents with a single point of contact, improving information sharing and multi-agency working, allowing problems to be identified and appropriate support to be provided at the right time to prevent families reaching crisis. Bernardo Scotland point out that it's essential to have an early warning, a universal early warning system to identify the children who are most vulnerable. Indeed, as Malcolm Chisholm and other members have pointed out, the child at most risk is often the one who has not been identified as vulnerable. And that's why the named persons provisions have the overwhelming support not only of Bernardo's, but of almost every child welfare organisation, including Youth Link Scotland, Save the Children, Children First, Who Cares Scotland, Parenting Across Scotland, a fact that's been highlighted in the Chamber today by many members. But while Scottish Labour supports this policy in principle, we do have concerns about its implementation. And while we reject the scaremongering that's been encapsulated in Ruth Davidson's newspaper article at the weekend and in the political games that the Tories are embarking on in their motion today, we also believe that the Scottish Government has a lot more to do to genuinely get it right for every child, in particular to sell this policy to parents. As John Pentland has highlighted earlier, at each and every stage, we've said that the named person must work in practice and be properly resourced. And a real concern here is the impact on Scotland's health visitors, who have already been stretched to the limit, a point that has been raised by my colleague Neil Bibby. And only yesterday, the Royal College of Nursing warned of staff shortages, highlighting their concern that many of our health visitors are due to retire over the next 5 to 10 years. I noted the Minister's comments in response to Murdo Fraser raising this issue, and that is welcome. But the reality is that in health boards across Scotland, they're struggling to recruit and retain health visitors, and many have got large numbers of vacancies that they simply can't fill. With community nursing staff already working flat out, I think there's a real danger that the extra demands of acting as named persons could increase stress, sickness and staff turnover levels unless it's properly resourced. So, Presiding Officer, I know that the Scottish Government's named person policy is well-intentioned and it is one that Scottish Labour does support with qualifications, but it will only work well if it's properly resourced. And right now, as Ian Gray has warned, we are seeing resources squeezed and not provided. Whether it's our NHS, our councils, our police service or our teachers, our frontline services and staff are under growing pressure. And Mark Griffin highlighted many of the challenges here and also the challenges of delivering and resourcing children's services plans on the ground. I think it's also too about acting to ensure that resources that are available are allocated to support the policy and weighted according to needs, targeted so that they reach the most vulnerable children and families. That's the approach that Labour puts at the heart of our policies and our plans to ensure that funding always follows the children that are most in need. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, if the Scottish Government wants to make the named policy work, if it wants to gain support of parents across Scotland and the professionals on the ground who are expected to take on these additional roles, then there is an urgent need, I think, to explain much better to parents about what this policy is about and indeed what it's not about. I'm pleased that this sentiment has been echoed by members across the chamber, Labour members and also SNP members such as Stuart Maxwell. Scottish Labour wants to see the very best possible protection and support for our children. But there is no denying that in all our communities, parents have got real concerns about the named person provisions we are discussing today. It's time for the Scottish Government to take these concerns on board, to do more to communicate with parents, children and young people about what the named person means for them and to address the current shortfalls which stop us getting it right for every child. It's no good getting the principles right if you can't deliver, yet time and time again we pass laws in this place only to fail when it comes to ensuring they're implemented properly. So let's not just pass laws to get it right for our children. Let's make sure these laws are backed up with the resources, the support, the practical guidance to ensure that they really do make Scotland better. And this is especially important right now at a time when welfare reform means more children and more families are reaching crisis point. We want every child in Scotland to have a fair start. And we want to see our most vulnerable children protected. But fine aspirations are no good unless matched with the resources and the support to transform lives. The Government amendment today fails to give any guarantee whatsoever on resources for the named policy. And unfortunately, therefore, Scottish Labour will not be voting for it at decision time.
Thank you very much. Now call on Minister Aileen Campbell. Up to 8 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, we are always pleased to debate GIRFEC in the Parliament, a chance for us to reaffirm the principles that this chamber has repeatedly endorsed while debunking the persistent and at times malicious myths that continue to be recycled about the named person. And I think I would share that same weariness that was expressed by, I think, both Malcolm Chisholm and Mike Rizzle, that again we find ourselves having to, time and time again, counter those fears and smears peddled by the Tories in today's debate. But I am pleased to hear that, aside from the Conservatives, that so many members once again support the principle of what this Parliament passed into legislation 19 months ago. And I wanted to pick up on some of those points that have been raised. Many members did point to what Lord Carloway said when he mentioned that, when he said in his ruling that legislation does not involve the state taking over any functions currently carried out by parents in relation to their children. And that has always been a constant within the design and the development of this policy, tried and tested and proven to work through the Highland Pathfinder and tested through the courts twice.
Alex Johnson.
Before the Minister completes her contribution, will she deal with the question that was raised earlier? And that is, in relation to the issue of well-being and its definition, would a parent who chooses to refuse a vaccination be in a position to be overruled by a named person?
Mr.
I think, again, this just shows this fear and smear that continually comes from the Conservative benches and a refusal to kind of acknowledge the clear guidance that we've published yesterday, the clear evidence that proves that this approach exists. And I'm disappointed that he's continuing to go down that incredibly negative and scaremongering route. Because let's remember that this named person entitlement was designed in response to what parents told us they needed. And as Malcolm Chisholm rightly pleaded for us to remember, that that was where the origins came. A point of contact to avoid the painful telling and retelling of stories to a crowd of services. This is not, as Murdo Fraser says, parents being usurped or any of the hyperbolic language coming from the Tory benches.
This policy is about building on the relationships already in existence and working with families. And I would entirely agree with Liam MacArthur when he described the use of language as intemperate and irresponsible and deliberately spreading undue alarm. And also the words of Michael Russell when he described the approach from the Conservative benches as simply being untrue spin. So Ruth Davidson also, I think it's good that she sees that she's back in the chamber, despite having seemingly been quite gallus in the weekend's press. I believe her distasteful article cited wrongly and pretty irresponsibly the tragedy of Victoria Climbley. And as also we've heard from other members who have chosen to speak about the learning that we can take from some of the tragedies that have existed, unfortunately, in our country. That's, for example, when Sheriff Ruth Hanley said that, Ruth Anderson quoted, that the fatal accident inquiry into the death of Declan Haley, that said that there was no system in place whereby one of the agencies responsible for Declan's well-being was in overall charge, and there was no system whereby one named individual was responsible for coordinating all available information. And in the case of Victoria Climbery, over the years, Lord Lambing said, over the years, preventative work with families has been declining. As a result, the absence of a timely supportive intervention has allowed more family problems to deteriorate to the point of crisis. This trend has to be reversed. This can only be achieved if a higher priority is given to services working jointly in supporting families and helping them to overcome their difficulties. It's clear, Presiding Officer, the overwhelming message from child protection case reviews in England as well as in Scotland is that the failure of services to share relevant information has resulted in the full picture of a particular child's vulnerability being put together in time to allow professionals to take essential action. Now, to address, as well as listening and responding to some of the points that have been made today, I wanted to talk about some of the voices that we've heard from outside this chamber, the voices of those who work every day with children and families, those who are vulnerable and those who are not, those voices that should be raised in this debate. The Conservatives keep referring to the small number of voices that challenge the named person, but let's quote a handful of the others who are positive about this move. Alistair Gaw, the head of Social Work Scotland, who recently wrote, "There is a myth about the named person not being needed." He said, "Really, how often do we hear about children falling through the net, issues not picked up, early opportunities missed, families struggling on? Children and families can get to a crisis point before it's noticed that they need a bit of help. If we can prevent crisis by making one person responsible for ensuring people share information, that will go a long way towards helping children and families early on, preventing sometimes devastating consequences." And it's not just social work professionals either. John Butcher, the Director of Education and Youth Employment in North Ayrshire, spoke on behalf of his colleagues yesterday when he said, "The new law and guidance will improve the way services work to support children, young people and families, and we welcome the flexible approach to the named person role and function that it offers." And moreover, we have parents' groups who have been saying that same thing as well, despite what the Conservatives would have us believe. Implementation of something as important and as wide-ranging as GIRFEC takes time and close cooperation with those who will experience the changes most. And speaking about the publication of the guidance on GIRFEC that was published yesterday, Fiona Nicholson, the co-chair of National Parenting Forum Scotland, said, "We are pleased that the guidance has received inputs from a range of stakeholders, including parents and the MPFS, and recognise that the Scottish Government has taken account of the feedback received during the consultation period." And I could go on, and I could go on about the different people who have responded positively to the named person provision when they act, and about how this embeds early intervention, how it embeds the approach that will help children go on to fulfil their aspirations, their hopes, and lead, as Stuart Maxwell rightly noted, within their rights agenda, a good and positive childhood. We could go on to quote all and a huge number of people who have been wanting us to take this forward in a positive way. And I quote all those individuals to correct the distorted view that keeps getting bandied about the named person, that professionals don't want it, that parents don't welcome it, that those who work with our most vulnerable don't champion it, because it's simply not true. Of course, there are still challenges, and I will, as I said in my opening remarks, continue to work constructively and proactively with those who want to continue to work with us to take this implementation forward. Because we have invested £51 million for additional teachers, we have announced 500 additional health visitors to meet the needs of the Act, we've supported training and we've published guidance. There is, as always, always a need to do more, and we will take on board some of the points that have been made today and made from outside this chamber. But as Minister with the responsibility of doing my best by our children and young people, I will always strain every sinew to do this. We have proof and evidence that the GIRFEC approach works. We have proof it improves coordination of services, and we have proof it avoids costlier and more traumatic services by embedding early intervention and prevention. Now, I'll continue to be guided by our GIRFEC approach and looking to improve the children's wellbeing. I most certainly will not be guided by a party that has shown its true colours today. Party politicking over the wellbeing of our children while it systematically punishes them with their harsh welfare reforms. They have done a vote fast on their support of GIRFEC for the most cynical of politically opportune reasons. My focus will continue to do best by our children and ensure that we work towards creating the country that I think most of us at least want for our children to grow up in.
Thank you very much. Now Colin Gravin-Brown to wind up the debate. Mr Brown, you have until 5 o'clock.
Presiding officer, thank you. I think this has been a very worthwhile debate, and I shall endeavour to be as measured and as objective as possible. And I have to say, I think we've had some pretty valuable contributions from across the chamber today. Some of the contributions, clearly, I didn't agree with, but that doesn't mean the contribution wasn't valid and worthwhile and causes one to reflect on one or two points. Presiding officer, we have not done a vote fast, as the Minister suggested there. The Scottish Conservative Party has been very uncomfortable with the idea of a statutory, mandatory, universal named person service since day one of it being mentioned. We've opposed it from day one. We've opposed it relentlessly all the way through the bill process, and we oppose it today, even after the bill has been passed. Of course, I'll give way.
To work out why in 2009 in a debate about the GIRFEC, your members implored us to roll this out nationally.
Gavin Brown.
I have to say, I think Mary Scanlon, I don't know if the Minister was in the chamber at the time, but I think Mary Scanlon dealt with that point very well in an intervention where she said she liked the idea of ending silos, she liked the idea of combining services, she was impressed by the leadership of certain individuals within Highland Council, but she did not say at any point, and has not said at any point, that she is in favour of the named person legislation. And presiding officer, of course, in 2006, when the Pathfinder was set up, there was not a named person named at the time. It developed years later, and so it is not something that the Conservatives have changed their view on at all, and I have to say it's not something we're likely to do any time soon. Presiding officer, it's the universal approach and the mandatory element, as Murdo Fraser talked about, that we have the biggest difficulty with. And we don't actually believe that the policy is as popular as the Scottish Government and others will have you believe. We've only heard reference to one actual survey of parents from the Scottish Parent Teacher Council, which suggested that 74% of parents who were interviewed were against the policy. I haven't heard a counter survey or counter poll from the Scottish Government at any point during the legislation or at any point today. And it would be very interesting to hear if they have plans to conduct a full poll survey of parents just to back up the strong assertions that they've made over the course of the afternoon. Now, presenting officer, I think it is fair to say that most children's charities, or certainly most ones that I've heard from, do favour the legislation. I think that's a perfectly fair point to make. But aside from the children's charities, actually the position is very, very mixed. We heard quotes this afternoon of concerns from the police. We heard quotes from the government of support from the police. Okay, so we have a mixed response from the police. We heard strong quotes from both sides of the chamber today in relation to social work, but we heard from some social workers who were very concerned about it. We've heard from parents who are concerned about it, and I have to say, purely anecdotally, parents who will say they're in favour of it when they say, I'm in favour of it, but of course it doesn't apply to me, take a very different view when they realise it absolutely does apply to them, and it is mandatory, and whether they like it or want it or need it, their child too will have a named person. In one moment I will. We've heard from the EIS, we've heard from teachers again on both sides of the divide, but the position is this: there is clearly not universal support for this policy. There is clearly a very, very mixed response and some pretty damning quotes, I have to say, both in the Finance Committee and the Education Committee, and that has to be a concern going forward with a universal policy for those who are expected to implement it, and those to whom it applies are not in favour of it and have deep concerns. And I said I'd give way to Mark MacDonald.
I'm sure that the continued propagation of misleading hyperbole by the Tories has absolutely nothing to do with public perceptions around named person. But can Gavin Brown just answer me one question? We've heard from his members about the fact that it's the universal element of this that they have difficulty with. Yet, on the other hand, we've also heard members who believe that the very role of named person in some way usurps the role of parents. So are they opposed to the named person role in principle regardless, or is it simply the universal application? Because we seem to be getting arguments from both sides of that.
Gavin Brown.
Not sure we have. And I have to say, to accuse me of hyperbole, I think, is a little unfair, given what I think I've said over the course of the last 4 minutes. But I'll check the record to see if anything that I've said could be classed as hyperbole. We have great concerns with the universality. We have great concerns with the principle that I don't think it replaces. I think, you know, there's a myth about the myth here that somehow we're saying it completely replaces parental control. I don't think that's true, and I don't think we've said that at all today. But I think in some circumstances, it has the potential to undermine the relationship between parent and child. Let me just give you one example, because the Scottish Government say in their press release, and this was a press release from yesterday, children and young people will have access to a named person service, a single point of contact for help, support and advice for families and those working with children if they need it, making it sound as if it is not mandatory in any way, making it sound as if it's only there for those who need and want it, which we know isn't true. And while there has been statement today from the Scottish Government that you don't have to listen to what the named person says, if the parent chooses not to engage, then they don't have to do so. But what we do know from the guidance is that if a parent, on a point of principle, chooses not to engage with the named person, chooses not to engage with the process, a negative inference about that parent can be drawn. And I don't think that is acceptable. I think if parents don't want to engage for perfectly valid reasons, absolutely, the idea that a negative inference can be drawn about them by the named person and indeed the authorities more widely, I don't think is fair and I don't think is acceptable. Yeah. Presiding officer, we have objections in principle, as I think Liz Smith outlined very strongly, and we have over the course of the debate. But we have equally strong objections on pragmatism. We've heard from previous Labour and Lib Dem speakers that they share some of those concerns too, although less so, I have to say, over the course of today. We know that it's going to be difficult, not just for the NHS, but for local authorities more widely over the course of the next few years. And the reality is we cannot spend the money twice. So any money that we spend on children, on named persons for children who don't need them or don't want them, is money that by definition we cannot spend on children who desperately need the support and help. Yep. Let's not pretend that creating a giant bureaucracy doesn't cost money. Because if you look at the financial memorandum, presiding officer, let me just give you one example for it about the costs of it. In year one, for local authority admin costs, the Scottish Government estimate is £2 million. That's £2 million on admin by local authorities that, by definition, we cannot spend on teachers or anybody else helping those who actually need it. That £2 million breaks down into 100,000 hours of administration. This bureaucracy is estimated to create 100,000 hours of administration in year one of it being set up, presiding officer. That is our point about the diversion of resources. Now, I won't quote the Labour MSP from a previous debate, just in case I harm their political career, but a very prescient quote, I think, from them in the last time we debated this. And they said this: time that is spent filling in forms for children who will never need intervention is time that would be better spent on children who are in desperate need of help. I'm hardly going to give way in the middle of a quote. In desperate need of help. Resources that are diverted to children who are loved, nurtured and thriving are resources that are not spent on the neglected and the vulnerable. And I pointed out the £2 million, presiding officer, as just one item in that financial memorandum that shows that some money, be it millions or tens of millions, could be diverted away from those who need it most and being spent on those who neither need or want the provision. Now, the other point that I think came up in the debate a number of times is just in the resourcing of the policy as a whole. And this is where I have to say the Scottish Government, through the course of their pushing the bill through, have been living in fantasy land. absolute fantasy land because, presiding officer, they have suggested... It's Mike Russell, former minister. I will give way to Mr Russell.
Michael Russell.
I just wanted to take the member back to the 100,000 hours. That equates to, in my reckoning, 40 hours a school in Scotland, which is less than an hour a week in each school for the well-being and support of children. Doesn't seem a lot to me.
Presiding officer, if we're spending 100,000 hours and several million pounds on creating a bureaucracy, my simple view is that that would be better spent, far better spent on those who need or want it. But perhaps Mr Russell and I will just have to disagree on that point. But the point I was coming to was this, and I see that time is tight, presiding officer. The Scottish Government have said it will cost, it will cost teachers or the local authorities £8 million in year one, which on the face of it, I have to say, doesn't sound a huge amount of money for the actual help that would be required and brought in there. So fair enough. But in year two, the Scottish Government's view is that the cost would be nil. The Scottish Government think that by putting into place a policy for 1 year, suddenly there will be no costs and no extra resources required whatsoever thereafter. That is absurd. Anybody who knows anything about preventative spend knows that it takes time, knows that it can take 5 years, 10 years, or even a generation in order to actually implement change and to actually then get outcomes and savings. The idea that it can be done on a shoestring budget in a single year is ridiculous. And for that reason, along with our reasons of principle and pragmatism, we are very much against the named person policy and will continue to be against it. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on named persons. We now move to the next item of business, which is consideration of business motion number 15021. In the name of Joe Fitzpatrick, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a business programme, any member wish to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 15021.
Formally moved.
No member has asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the Chamber. The question is that motion number 15021, in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick, be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of business motion number 15022. In the name of Joe Fitzpatrick, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a stage one timetable for the Scottish Elections Dates Bill. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 15022.
Moved.
Thank you. No members asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the Chamber. The question is that motion number 15022, in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick, be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. There are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. Can I remind members that in relation to today's debate on named persons, if the amendment in the name of Aileen Campbell is agreed, the amendment in the name of Ian Gray falls. The question then is that amendment number 14999.2 in the name of Aileen Campbell, which seeks to amend motion number 14999 in the name of Liz Smith on named persons, be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Parliament's not agreed. We move to a vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 14999.2 in the name of Aileen Campbell is as follows. Yes, 66. No, 14. There are 28 abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed to, and the amendment in the name of Ian Gray falls. The next question is that motion number 14999 in the name of Liz Smith as amended on named persons be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Parliament's not agreed. We move to vote. Members should cast their votes now.
Yeah, you're right.
Order. The result of the vote on motion number 14999 in the name of Liz Smith as amended is as follows. Yes, 65. No, 14. There were 28 abstentions. The motion as amended is therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time. We are now moving to members' business. Members should leave the chamber, should do so quickly and quietly. I would much better be here.